You're still watching the budget reading, pre-conversation, if I could call it, on Urban TV. And in a few minutes, the Minister of Finance is going to be at Serena with that famous briefcase to unveil to us the budget of 2019-2020. A very exciting time for us, and what a time to be alive. And in studio right now, I've been joined by Conan Businge, an education editor, a new vision, and it's still Sandra on my right from Uganda Debt Network. Now, just during the break, Sandra, and let me first give you a break and come to Conan. Conan,
sure.
What's your take, just a general take on the budget? You've had a glimpse of it, you know where we're putting what. What's your take on the general?
I know, like, when you look at the direction the country is taking for investment, obviously, I think they're making the right move, especially when you look at this so much outcry that comes with unemployment for Ugandans, but also looking at a greater picture of where you want to take the country, if you are going to take it to another level by 2030. So you need to think completely different. And we are moving in the area of industrialization, but also looking at the area of productivity, but also being able to offer individuals money, because there will be, I think, additional money put in Uganda Development Bank to be able to have more money to give to SMEs. So I do believe it looks positive in terms of investment. I know there will be queries about agriculture, there will be queries, but you see, one of the things, if you're going to make like a country grow, agriculture is supported by several things, like infrastructure development, which includes borrowing so much money which is being put on roads. Also, it goes issues of investing in education and also investing in energy, and those are the core areas where they put so much of the money. So really, I do believe the other sectors will be enough to support agricultural development of a country, and that has always been the case of investment for years. That agriculture always gets a smaller portion, but you know agriculture is being supported by several other sectors for its survival. Mm-hmm. What is the use of you growing matoke which you can't transport to Kampala? Mm-hmm. Sure. So I believe it's a positive trend we are taking. Mm-hmm. There are also worries, but I have my own personal worries we probably can get into later.
Later.
Yeah, sure.
Back to you, Sandra. We talk of a very huge debt. We are heavily indebted. And a Ugandan, probably in Nguru right now, is saying, but listen, I go and pay for all the services. If I'm going to get a passport to become a citizen of my own country, I pay money. If I'm going to a government hospital, there's some money I pay. And now recently, government said, you're going to pay for using Facebook and Twitter. Basically, Ugandan is feeling squeezed. Isn't that enough money to pay Uganda's debt in probably 2-3 years? What are other sources as well for paying our debt?
What you've said is exactly an explanation of the negative impact of debt, is that government, which is not a person, will borrow on behalf of the country, but the individuals that make up the country are then going to pay back that debt in terms of taxes and all these non-tax revenues. So unfortunately, we can't tax people to pay debt. Government has other things it must do. Public services need to continue being availed. You still have to construct roads, you still have to construct hospitals, you have to buy drugs. There is so much that needs to be done. You can't say, I'm only going to raise revenue to pay back the debt. So the thing about the debt situation we are in now is that we need to take a break and first analyze where we are as a country. Yes, we've borrowed, but how has this debt that we've borrowed performed? Is it underperforming? Is it performing effectively? Is it overperforming? Then we can see how to raise, because ideally when you borrow, it's for development. Development means you're going to earn more revenue from whatever you've borrowed. For example, if they're borrowing to do these oil roads, they know, they're thinking that when we start producing oil, oil will be easily transported and exported, and we shall get revenue and pay back the debt. So those are the dynamics that surround the debt. So where we are now, we need to take a break, pause and see how best can we do with what we have. You see that? Because if we continue borrowing, if you're comparing a payment of what? 2.9 trillion or something, going into debt interest payments against
10 trillion.
Yeah.
I think 2.9 is for domestic areas.
Yes.
So against a public debt of 44.3 trillion, that's not even a quarter of it. So you've not paid back much. And that's interest, not principal. So you have to think about all these things. But taxing Ugandans to pay debt that will not work.
Do you think that government making repayment of debt a priority is a good thing?
In a way it is. It shows that we want to get done with that phase of our lives and move on into something else economically. But the downside to it is that it comes at the cost of social expenditures. It comes at the cost of the education sector. It comes at the cost of the health sector. In other words, money that you could have diverted to develop these very critical sectors, which are, you know, pertinent to human daily life, they're not benefiting.
It's transferred to paying debt.
Yes.
Conan, the education sector is getting just about, 3.2 trillion shillings.
Yeah.
Do you feel sad as a person who comes from that background?
Sad, true. Mm. Just as a rejoinder to what she was saying, if you have a budget that doesn't so much look at social development and you so much go to an area where you're just going to invest, especially for capital development, infrastructure development in this sense, it makes sense for a country. If you're going to move a country from pre-middle income status, it makes sense. But you know, you want to send a signal to the Ugandans that you must be ready to still take the rope, I was going to use a certain analogy, but keep it straight to the beat, is that Ugandans must be ready to continue sacrificing for bigger time, for longer time, for us to be able to go to a level where we can have health and probably education having the bigger share of the country's budget. That's going to probably take us another probably 10 years, probably a decade, depending on how fast this works for us.
If you look at that on your screen, saying in the education sector, government plans to continue implementing the policy of having a government primary school per parish, a secondary school per sub-country through grant aiding. Again, she's going to come in and say these are dates. And construction in a phased manner and establishing technical and vocational institutes per district with focus on completing outstanding works.
Yeah.
Does that make you happy? Per parish, per sub-county?
It is. It's a very good direction, especially looking at our budget. Obviously, when you look at the real budget for the education sector, in terms of percentage allocation compared to the other sectors, there has been a decline. But that shouldn't worry anyone, because there's been a bit more money put to the education sector compared to the previous years. That has been the case with several other sectors, almost like in lands, in social development, in science and technology, in health and energy. There will be a decline percentage, but at least the money has gone up, which is positive. And what you're saying is very positive in the sense that to a common Ugandan, that is, when you look at by individual in your community, wherever you are, it's good that you're having more schools, more infrastructure being set up for you to be able to educate your children cheaply. We have one biggest problem in this country. Where we are heading, if you're not very careful, government will no longer be able to fund education. A rate of, actually, Minister, First Lady, and Education Minister the other day, she talked about it, she laid it somewhere in her speech. And was happy that she was saying it. That was during the World Bank report launch. She said, while we are heading, the population is growing faster than our ability to fund the budget for it. And that comes to what exactly she was saying. If you have more money being put to works and transport, security, energy, and obviously not, education comes third. But you realize that you are giving 6.4 trillion to infrastructure development. You're giving 3.6 to security, and you're giving 3.3. to education. You said education is almost just a half of what you're putting on infrastructure development. I'm not saying you're making a wrong move. I'm only showing you that we have now better and bigger priorities, which are very important. And I agree with the government on allocation of money to that end. But to a common Ugandan, you must appreciate the fact that now you have to put in more money for the survival of your social services. You must be able to pay for your own walk into the hospital. You must be able to pay for your child's education, especially now the times are changing. And if you care about your child being one of the best, well-trained children for the next job market, which is evolving every other day. I'm sitting here today, probably when you talk to me next year, I can only talk to you on a teleconferencing because times will have changed probably. Technology is moving very fast. If I'm training a child right now, I'm not going to train a child to be able to sit in your place in the next 10 years. My son, he will sit in Washington and host a show on Urban TV. That's where technology is going. But the question is, how do you get to fund that your child gets the best quality education that you need for your child to be able to work in the next 10 years?
Yeah.
So you must put in more money at your own cost. And it's not going to change tomorrow. Don't expect tomorrow where you're going to wake up in the next year with a budget of education and health being up. For the next 10 years, probably you're going to still have infrastructure development, repaying of these debts we've incurred as areas of which are taking more money. I was just telling you, we're spending 10 trillion shillings on debt repayment,
Yes.
For external and internal. So you're practically seeing that you're spending almost a quarter of your budget on debt repayment.
What does the teacher at
home, close to half what you're putting to the education sector.
What does the teacher at home right now going to watch the budget reading think when he gets that the education sector is getting less than it got last year, considering they were asking
in terms of
money.
Percentage?
Yes.
You should feel positive about it, because from a general picture, the teacher should be worried. But if you're looking directly at your own pocket as a teacher, on a small scale, you don't have to worry so much, because government is already planning. It's one of the things that bothers me so much are supplementary budgets. Obviously, before this year financial year ends, there'll be a supplementary budget for teachers' salaries.
Teachers' salaries, yes.
I can bet the president promised them the other time, even if they don't get all the money they want, there will be salary increment. So even if you don't get it in this budget, trust me, there will be more money for them. Because at the end of the day, I think this country solves things by strikes. which is a terrible trend.
Yes,
once
very, very
riot,
terrible.
You've got to give them more money. And obviously, the other thing as a teacher, you need to feel good about this, because when you construct more schools, more technical institutions, at the end of the day, there will be more teachers who don't have jobs right now from universities and institutions who will be able to get jobs. There will be more teachers hired. Obviously, one of the things that we've avoided doing is increasing the wage bill, but they will not avoid it. You can't build schools and they remain empty. There will be more teachers hired. So if you're a teacher, you should be very positive that there will be more people to get hired, more people will be hired. But also looking at the budget, obviously, education is still taking the fourth, sorry, it's the third of all sectors in the country. You should be proud.
That you're the third?
Yes,
you're not tourism.
What were the guys of tourism, which actually brings in more money compared to services which we are spending on money on, because we get more money from tourism. Yeah. Education is a consumption thing. You're actually getting more money. So thank...
It's a long-term investment. It's
a long-term investment. Yeah. So you should thank the government that actually
for
is
putting
you
number
money.
Three,
because you could have woken up and you were down in tourism.
Let me go to
tourism. It's almost the second last.
Sandra, what do you think when government says that it's going to do all this in education, but it's going to do this through increasing aids? It's going to use aid and debt. What comes to mind?
We can never have enough resources. That's of a truth. We have so many things we want to do, but the resources will always be, in most cases, will be limited. So for us to borrow for education, I think is good. I wouldn't complain, because you're educating these young people who are going to grow up and grow your economy. So that means it might not be in the short term, but in the long run, you'll get dividends back on your investment. And if you keep considering the fact that World Bank has been like the biggest funder for education in Uganda, that's a concessional donor. So there's no, you don't have to be jittery about it, because they'll give you maturity periods of what, 35 years,
yeah,
40
years.
Years. Exactly.
More about less than 1% interest repayment at times.
Exactly.
But
by then
a child...
If a Chinese
is actually giving you
Chinese
money for building teachers' houses, you better be very
careful. Because it's going to come... There's a lot we can talk about,
yes,
about education, but Sandra, I'd like to let you leave. I'd like to say thank you very much for being on the show. Let's head into a short break, and the guy who's going to sit in Sandra's seat is going to be a young guy. Someone who's just at university, and probably they'll give us a more realistic perspective of what is on ground. Is our money doing what it's supposed to be? Are we allocating the right money for the right sector? After the short break.